Capuchin Thalir online programs. This is part of the Solanas KC Holistic Welfare Center, Vilupuram in India. We give motivational trainings and empowerment for religious and lay leaders, formators and formees, teachers and students, families, parents and children. We also give counseling to the individuals and the communities and the families. We conduct retreats and monthly recollections. Welcome to Solanas KC Holistic Welfare Center. Contact the director, Nitya, YFM Cap. TotalExcellenceNow@gmail.com. Dear brothers and sisters in Jesus Christ, welcome to the Capuchin Online International Programs. As a part of the programs for the formators, we have been listening to Reverend Father Jerry, a Jesuit priest, on understanding the youth of today, being led by God's experience, and pilgriming with the formees. And these 2 days, we are going to listen to Reverend Father Wilson, a Capuchin friar, on the latent and manifest motives in the vocation and in the formees, and also on self-care of the formators. Father Wilson is the director of the Anugraha Institute of Social Psychotherapy. Welcome, Brother Wilson Capuchin.
Special thanks to Father Nitya Sagayam for extending this opportunity to me. Happy to meet you all. So, formators, right at the beginning, I want to make a note that you are more important to the order, to the congregation, more than the provincials and generals, right? Because you are the ones who are really shaping your order, your congregations. So really, really excited and happy to address you all. Friends, do we come across religious people who behave this way? When they join, they are so sweet, they are so good, so obedient, very submissive, so supportive and cooperative. But after a few years, perhaps after ordination or final vows or whatever, you can see that same person behaving in a totally different way. Okay, friends, there's a world of difference in that person. Something has changed in that person. And sometimes we wonder, how did we promote such people and all that? Okay, friends? Friends, the way our formees behave during formation time may not be their real self. In fact, the real self may be lurking beneath the surface, and it doesn't show up until they become full-fledged. Then the real self might really show up. Friends, do you come across religious people that way? No, the way they behave earlier, the way they behave later is very different. But friends, supposing if the formators are sensitive to a certain part of them that is hidden beneath the surface, and if you are able to bring it out, if you are able to address it, okay, they can become excellent, excellent religious. So friends, in this session, let's deal with two types of motives the formees have. One is called manifest motive, the other one is latent motive. Friends, a little request is, when this is being shared, can you first apply to yourself? No, the best way of learning is first we apply all these elements to ourselves and see how far we are healthy. Okay, friends? And then if you can make use of all this information in your formation, friends, you can really, really be effective formator. Okay, friends? So let's deal with this. The two aspects of formation, The motives our formies are having, okay? So there are two types of motives. One is called manifest motive. The other one is latent motive. Okay, friends? Friends, manifest motive is what the formies are expressing during formation time. What they are manifesting. Okay, friends? Okay. Sorry. Friends, so manifest motive is what you see them doing externally. Friends, most of the time our evaluation is based on what we observe externally, right? That is manifest motive. We see them behaving externally. Like, you know, we have a checklist. We say so-and-so is punctual, very prayerful, obedient, and very industrious, studious, tick, 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 and then we promote them. Friends, but very often we are not aware, beneath this surface, there is something like cancer that is hidden, which we are not aware of. Friends, if there is a way we can become aware of this hidden nature, we call it latent motive. Okay, friends? Supposing if you are able to become aware of the latent motive within them, and then we can address this and help them become aware of it and work on this latent motive. And friends, their behavior before final vows and after final vows will be the same. Friends, in fact, in formation, the foremost task of the formator is to identify the latent motive in the formees. No, whatever latent motive they have, we have to sense it, pick it up, and then we can start processing them. They can become excellent religious people. Okay, friends? So let's deal with this latent motive. Hope I'm clear about this manifest motive, right? Whatever they express openly is manifest motive. So we don't need to analyze manifest at all. Then sometimes the manifest motive and the latent motive could be just the opposite. Okay, friends? Now, these formies are not pretending, but they are unaware. Okay, friends? Not that they are pretending to be good and they are bad inside, but they are motivated. They want to become somebody like St. Teresa of Child Jesus, or they want to become like somebody like St. Francis of Assisi or Don Bosco, or St. Ignatius of Loyola, or Alphonsus Ligori. They want to become somebody like that saint. They are really motivated. They are very sincere about their goal and everything. But they themselves are not aware that after some time, no, that is something within is going to manifest. Okay, friends? So if the formators are aware of this beforehand, okay, and if you can process these, friends, they can really, really grow. So whatever they profess outside is manifest motive. Now let's go into the latent motive. Friends, here I like to discuss about something called a mind lock. So for every formee in their childhood, there was a little lock created in the mind, and they are not aware of it. They are, friends, they are totally oblivious to this little lock inside their mind. Friends, it can remain hidden for many years, and most likely it'll show up for some people right after their final vows or ordination, and for some religious, around their midlife transition. We all speak about midlife transition from 35 to 45 years. Friends, for most of our religious, it might show up around midlife. That's why there's a term called a midlife crisis used for this. Supposing if you are able to address latent motive, even in formation, okay, friends, people may have smooth midlife transition. Okay, friends? Friends, this mind lock is referred to in the Bible as stiff-necked people. If you read it, Exodus chapter 32, verse 9. Okay, Yahweh says, these people are stiff-necked people. Okay, in the gospel, we see Matthew chapter 23, where Jesus really reprimands the Pharisees. Okay, friends. Now, there are different terms, different psychologists are using for this. Like Sigmund Freud calls it mind fixation. Martin Seligman calls it learned helplessness. Harvey Jenkins calls it internalized oppression. No matter what term you use, you know, they all mean the same. Again, friends, neither the formee nor the formated is aware of this. But there's a way of knowing this. Friends, this mind lock happens at some age in their childhood or before joining the congregation or order. So first, there is a little fixation created. Afterward, there is a stuck point. After the stuck point, they don't change. And it goes beneath their conscious level to the unconscious mind. They are not even aware of this. That's why Pharisees were creating headache to Jesus, but they were least aware that they were not doing the right thing. They thought they were right. Okay, friends? Recently, an experiment was done in an aquarium, okay, fish tank. Friends, we all have seen this in fish tank, okay? Okay. Friends, in a fish tank, aquarium, you have seen a lot of fish moving around. And when we drop food on one side, all the fish rush and they start having that food. You drop food on the other side, they all rush back to this place. Okay, scientists did something interesting. One morning, all the fish were hungry. They dropped food on the right side of the aquarium. And the fish all rushed and they were all busy having food. Meanwhile, they inserted a glass piece, a partition right in the middle. And the fish were not aware of this. Okay, they were busy eating and a glass piece was inserted. Now, it was only a little food on the other side, okay, on that side. Now, what scientists did, when they were finished with eating, they dropped food on the other side, the left side of the aquarium. So what happened? All the fish, they started rushing. Now, what happens? They can go halfway through, then there is glass, right? But the fish cannot see the glass. But they are mystified, they are confused, because they are not able to go to the other side of the aquarium. They can see the food, but they are unable to move. So what happened? They keep on bumping against the glass many times that day. But no matter how they try, they are unable to go to the other side, right? Slowly they figure out it's impossible to go to the other side. So every morning scientists would drop food on one side and the other side. So they were unable to go to the left side of the aquarium. Friends, after a week, you know what they would do? Every time they saw food, they would move, and when they approached the center, the middle, they would slow down, touch the glass and go back. And the third week, they would try only once a day. By a fourth week, the fish were not even, they were not venturing into the other side. They were not making any effort at all because they think it is useless to go to the other side. Okay, friends? Now, on the 30th day, scientists removed the glass partition in the center. Now, it's free to move around, right? They can move. You know, one morning, they were not given food on this side. Rather, they dropped food on the left side of the aquarium. You know what? The fish would not move to the other side. Why? The partition moved from the aquarium, you know, into their mind. They developed a belief that it is impossible to go to the other side. Okay, friends? Once, so this is where the fixation starts. Okay, friends? Friends, then they are in this stuck point. Now, something very interesting. Scientists, they literally picked up these fish and they dropped on the other side where there was food. You know what all the fish did? They all rushed back to that part and they refused to go to the other side. Friends, this is called learned helplessness, mind fixation, stiff-necked nature, according to Bible. Okay, friends? Every one of us, we have some fixations like this, which we are not aware of. And most probably, we developed these mind fixations in our childhood, in our teenage time, before we joined the congregation. And friends, these fixations can remain beneath the surface. They show up much later. So let's go through some of the mind fixations the formies might be having. Okay. Friends, most of the mind blocks, they start from one of these. Unfulfilled needs. For example, a child has got a need to be loved. Okay, friends, supposing they were not given enough of love in their childhood. Mom did not love them enough. Dad ignored the child. Now, afterwards, they start looking for exclusive friendship, right? Yeah. And it becomes such a strong need, many of them even leave the congregation, realizing that it's a very strong need. They are unable to handle it. Okay, friend, they succumb to that. Second one is unfinished business. Supposing there is a young boy, girl in their home, they were so angry with mama, dad, especially dad, and they couldn't show that anger. Why? Dad was powerful. He was, you know, controlling the child. You know what? Such children tend to suppress their anger toward dad. It can remain quiet until they become final professed or after final vows. Friends, they begin to show up that, you know, they become very inimical toward the superior, provincial, general, or people who are authorities. They turn against authorities and do every harm possible. It's only, you know, the anger they had that was unfinished business, now they are transferring that to people and authority. Friends, third is unintegrated self. What is that? Okay. Whatever I'm ashamed of, I will try to fix it in an unhealthy way. Okay, friends. Take for example, I remember a sister who was a principal of a big school. You know what? She would organize functions every month, and she would request every teacher, she would appoint herself a teacher to say, no, you have to give a speech on me. These are my good qualities, okay? And so you go through all these good qualities of mine, and you can also add few more qualities, and you have to keep on praising me. Okay, so she would organize a lot of functions where she would be the center of attention. Okay, friends, we are here to serve, but this religious person wants to be the center of attention. That is unintegrated self. Okay, friends, whatever they are ashamed of, they try to compensate. Friends, now let us go forward and deal with locks one by one. Okay, friends, number one is addiction lock. Friends, sorry, all these graphics are just for fun's sake. When I say addiction, it's not only alcohol. It could be any kind of addiction. Okay? Friends, I'll give you an example. Once, a priest came to me for counseling. Okay? This priest was an excellent priest, but he had a problem. What? He was addicted to electronic gadgets. Okay, friends, he was very strongly addicted to electronic gadgets. Okay, even though he was a very motivated priest, he was doing a good mission work, but he was strongly addicted to electronic gadgets. That means any new electronic gadget he had to buy, he had a strong compulsion. For example, he had the latest iPhone, and when a new model was introduced, he threw away this expensive phone and he bought a new one. Even though, you know, that was not needed for him. But he was so addicted to gadgets. So, friends, people saw him having, you know, like he had 8 LCD projectors in his presbytery, 8. And people saw this, they complained to the bishop and he was sent to me. Okay, friends, he said he is aware of it, but he's unable to come out of it. So, friends, he wanted help. Then I asked him about his childhood. Okay, then he said, when he was a little boy, he lost his mom. Friends, anybody who doesn't receive enough of love from mom, they are prone to addictions. Okay, so when he lost his mom, he didn't get enough of love. Now his dad was working as a security guard, you know, watchman in a school run from the by the diocese. Okay, friends, this boy was working in a local medium school, but the principal told his dad, "See, you are doing rendering good service to our institute, so you can put your son in." You know, it is English medium school. They were having 2 schools. The other one is for posh, the higher standard one. So principal said, why don't you put your son in the other school and you don't have to pay fees. Let him have free education. Dad was so excited and sent this boy there. Now this boy, he came from a poor family. He was placed among rich guys. They were having all sorts of electronic gadgets. Okay, but this boy, being a poor boy, could not even have those gadgets. Friends, those years, they were having this Walkman, they were having electronic watch, they were having this video games, those days, all those equipments. And this boy was really, really, you know, wanting to use them, but he came from a poor family. Boys never shared those things with him. Why? They all knew that he was the son of the security. They looked down on this boy. He had a terrible inferiority complex, but he had a real longing for those electronic gadgets. Okay, friends? Now, when he was doing his studies in the school, there was a class teacher who was a priest. He was so impressed by the priest. The priest encouraged him and inspired him. So, friends, he joined the diocese. When he joined the diocese, he really wanted to be somebody like St. John Maria Vianney. Okay, friends, now, during formation time, he was really, really saintly, very good. In fact, he led a frugal life, very simple, only 2 boxes, okay, his belongings. Friends, during theology time, his rector told him he had some benefactors from Singapore and they were his sponsors, okay. The rector asked him to write letters, you know, to those people, wishing them on Christmas, Easter, and birthday, and he was doing it. Friends, for his ordination, the benefactors were down, okay, and they were there. They gave him a gift. You know what gift? 1 month vacation after his ordination in Singapore. So he went to Singapore, friends. He led a very good life, okay, very simple life. So when he went to Singapore, he had a wonderful time. He was taken to different parishes and he was saying mass. He had a good honeymoon, you know, we say priesthood honeymoon, okay? Toward the end, he was about to return. In the evening flight, morning, they took him to a big electronic shop. And they said, hey boy, you are our spiritual son. You know, you might need little electronic gadgets. You go pick up whatever you want. We will pay at the counter. So they sat near the counter. Friends, the moment he entered that big stall, electronic shop, he looked at those electronic objects. What happened? That anchor, you know, the fixation, that anchor got released. You know what? Friends, right away he became avaricious. He started grabbing things. There were electronic things which he didn't need. He grabbed them also. He brought so much to the counter, even the benefactors were surprised. They said, my dear boy, you already have a mobile. Why do you need a pager? Okay, friends, pager is an old electronic thing. You know, when there was no mobile, they were using pager to page, to send messages. When they asked, he said, no, I need them. Friends, even though it was a big money, they spent for him. You know, they were happy to spend. he came back. From that time onwards, friends, that particular, it's, we call it anchor. Okay, he was anchored when he was a little boy. Now it got released. Now I'll tell you when this anchor was formed. Okay, friends, at some point anchor will be formed. Okay, so when this boy, friends, let me call him Ye. Okay, Father A. I don't want to say the real name, Father A. Okay, when A was a 10th grade, 10th standard boy, he was studying in school. He was perfectly all right, good boy. But, you know, he was having this liking for electronic objects. Okay, friends, one morning as he entered the school, the principal called him and said, "Ye, come here." He said, "I need a Bible because we have assembly. I have to read a passage from the Bible. Have this room key. Go to my room. Open the room. Bring my Bible. It's on the table." He said, "Yes, Father." He ran. He opened the door. When he entered the room, friends, he was astounded looking at the room of the principal. Why? It was air conditioned, you know, well furnished, and a false ceiling and wallpaper and tiles. And here he saw a very expensive sports bike. The other side, he saw a good car. Friends, then he saw DVD player and a big home theater and all sorts of electronic gadgets in his room. Friends, the moment he saw that, his mind unknowingly, it linked the priesthood with the electronic gadgets. Am I clear? Friends, that's the time an anchor is formed. But friends, this anchor can remain. No, it went to his subconscious mind. Friends, how long it took for him to create an anchor? Anchor, not anger, anchor. Okay? Friends, it took only 10 seconds. He just looked at them and his mind made an association. Then he realized he had to take the Bible. He took the Bible, locked the door, went to the priest. Okay, friends? So this particular anchor remained quiet until he went to Singapore. He looked at the electronic shop. Poof, that anchor was released. From that time on, he became addicted to electronic gadgets. Am I clear? Friends, a priest living in a mission area having 8 LCD projectors in his presbytery is too much, right? He literally showed me those, but he had a craving for that. He would somehow pester his benefactors to send money. He was buying all those gadgets. Okay, friends? Now, so what can cause such an addiction? Friends, lack of mother bonding in the childhood and lack of love. Friends, later on they can develop, okay, addiction. Now what happens to these people? Until they can satisfy their addiction, they are happy. Otherwise they can get really depressed. Okay, friends, so that's. Friends, in the Bible, okay. So for these people, pleasure becomes a predominant factor, even in the religious life. They are preoccupied either with food or drink or internet or mobile or video games or porn or sex, money, even people. Such people can develop passivity later. They shun pain, suffering, hardship, and all the time they want to have pleasure. Okay, friends? But this will not show up until they are full-fledged. That's a problem. Next. Friends, the character in the Bible who has got addiction lock is King Herod. Okay, he had all sorts of addiction. He was addicted to power. He was addicted to money. Friends, King Herod who killed John the Baptist. Okay, that Herod. He was addicted to sex. He was addicted to alcohol. He was addicted to money. Okay? Friends, a good example of addiction lock is Idi Amin from Uganda. Due to lack of time, I'm not going deeper into this. Friends, somebody who was addicted, who came out of it, was one Anthony Robbins from the US. Friends, he was also not loved when he was a child. And when he grew up, he became so addicted, friends, He was weighing 130 kilos at some point. 130 kilos. Why? He would eat and drink and this one. But at some point, he realized it was lack of mother's love. So he started loving himself and expressing love toward others. He got healed. Now he's a great motivation speaker. He's called a motivation guru. Friends, the second lock is called a power lock. Power lock. Once, a religious sister came to me for counseling. Okay, friends? Now, her problem was this. She was a principal of a very big school for 18 years. Now, through those 18 years, initially she was good, but later she became a money monger and it became scandalous. Okay, friends, she was swindling a lot of money. So 18 years afterwards, she was given a transfer and she refused to move. Why? That was the biggest school in the province. So she was sent to me for counseling. When she came to me, she said, see, when I was a novice, I actually wanted to become somebody like St. Teresa of Child Jesus. But right now, I'm so attached to that position, I'm unable to step down. She says, right now, this is my feeling. I would rather leave the congregation than get transferred. Why? The new place is a very insignificant place. And she was not given a big post, big position. Why? Because she was involved in money scandal. Okay? But she refused to go. Friend, she said, I don't know why I'm behaving like this. In fact, I wanted to become somebody like St. Teresa, but now I'm a power monger. So why am I behaving like this? I asked about this sister's childhood. Let's see how the anchor was formed. Okay, so let me call this sister, Sister B. Friends, it's just alphabetical order I'm following. Okay, Sister B, when B was a small girl, she had an elder sister and parents all the time favored the elder sister. She used to tell B, good for nothing. You know, you are lazy bug, you are useless, you are a dunce, you are unintelligent, you are not talented, you are good for nothing. They all the time put her down. They all the time extolled her elder sister. Friends, this girl felt powerless throughout her childhood. And no, she felt dethroned by parents. She was pushed away, thrown away into garbage. That's a feeling she had. She felt like she was treated like garbage. Okay? Friends, when she was in 10th standard grade, this happened. Okay? One morning, she was in the assembly of 2,000 girls. Big assembly. She was right in the middle of 2,000 girls. She saw something on stage. You know, the principal, she was like Queen Elizabeth, okay? Maharani, seated on the throne, on stage. And 2,000 people under her control. At one point, okay, the principal waved her hand like this. A girl came running and she said, bring me a cup of water. Okay? And then she waved her hand like this. A teacher came running. And then she gave some instruction. Once again, she waved like this. The peon came running. She gave some instruction. The little girl looking at that sister, she feels tremendous. Imagine this sister having 2,000 people under her control. You know what an important person she is, VIP. This girl being, you know, feeling, she felt powerless. And here she sees a sister like Maharani, like Queen Elizabeth. Okay? Friends, right away within those 10 seconds, her mind made a link. Okay? Sister, principle, that is power. She connected power with being a religious nun and being the principal. Am I clear? She joined the congregation, very pious, and the saint she loved the most was St. Teresa of Child Jesus. And she used to write in her diary, I want to be another Teresa. That's what she told her novice mistress and all that. Friends, even after final vows, she was excellent. You know, she was very intelligent and very capable. The day she was made the principal of a school, that's when this anchor got released. Am I clear? Friends, from that time, she became a power monger. So what can cause this power lock? Friends, child neglect. Okay. When a child is totally neglected, they feel powerless. And then afterwards, they see religious people being powerful. Then they create an association in their mind. Okay. If I become a religious, I can be powerful. Friends, I am not, underestimating the power of vocation. Okay. I'm not saying she's not a genuine vocation. Okay. I'm saying, yeah, she might be okay. But the thing is, she's not aware of the latent motive. Okay, friends? Friends, even when she came to me, she was like 45 years old. She wasn't aware of her lock at all. In fact, she was wanting to leave the congregation until, you know, I explained to her everything. And then she began to realize that she had a problem. Okay, friends? So power mongers, okay, they look for a power position all the time. They want importance and significance. My friends, I'm sending you this PowerPoint. You can go through all the details, okay? Just to save time. Okay, friends. Friends, a good example from the Bible is King Saul. Okay, King Saul was a good man, a good king, very obedient to God. But the moment he realized, you know, David was shining better than King Saul. Women were praising David more than Saul. He became very jealous and negative, and he even wanted to kill David. So friends, he became a power monger. So I don't have to explain this too much. We would have seen a lot of religious people who are involved in power mongering. Okay. So we can see all sorts of politics, political games played in our provinces, in our congregation order. But friends, most of the people are not aware that they have an anchor inside and that is working. Okay, friends? Very rarely people are aware of this. Friends, a good example of power lock is one Robert Mugabe from Zimbabwe, Africa. Friends, he came from a good Catholic family. He was totally neglected when he was small because many children, he was put in a hostel where he was neglected completely. He was among hundreds of boys. Friends, later on, when he became the president, you know what he did? He became a strong power monger. Friends, he manipulated everything. He remained in power for 38 long years. He would never, ever step down. Finally, they forcefully brought him down. Friends, 38 years. He was the president till the age of 94. Okay. When he was forcefully brought down, within a short period of time, he died. Okay. Friends, that is that power lock. People, friends, he had even killed a lot of religious people and priests and bishops. Why? They were challenging his power. He was ready to even kill bishops. But we have a positive person called Jose Mujica from Central American country, Colombia. Friends, he also came from similar situation when he was small. He wasn't given power at all. He was neglected totally. But after becoming president, friends, he was such a lovely man. He was a simple man, all the time at the service of the people. And he gently stepped down and allowed another man to be the president. Okay, friends, there's something positive. Friends, the next lock is called Avenger Lock. Avenger Lock. Friends, one priest came to me, okay. He was deadly against his provincial and the council team. He was all the time giving a headache. Friends, that priest even sent all scandalous information to the media to be published against the provincial and all the council members. Why he was so angry with them? Because they took a little action on them. Okay, friends? Then he was sent to me for counseling. Friends, then while I was talking to him, he was deadly against all these people. Then as I spoke to him, friends, he was actually 50 years old. Right from the time he was ordained at the age of 30 till 50 years, he was against every provincial, every superior. He would turn against them and tarnish their image. So much so, nobody wanted him in their community. Okay, friends, he was such a hard-hearted person giving them headache. Okay, friends? Friends, then I realized when I spoke to him, when he was a little boy, his dad was a military officer. Every time he came home, dad used to be military officer and general even at home. Okay, dad used to humiliate him and beat him and do everything possible against this boy. Friends, one little event he shared with me that hurt him very badly. One day he happened to, he was playing with his younger sister. So this is a father C, okay? When C was 10 years old and he had a younger sister who was 5 years, okay? They both were having play, they were having fun. Friends, just, playfully, he just gave a little pat on her back, just like that, one little knock, that's all. But he did not even beat. But that was a time dad entered home and saw this boy hitting his younger sister. You know what he did? Dad caught hold of him and thrashed him. And you know what dad did? He asked the little girl to go to the toilet and fill a glass tumbler with her urine and bring it. Okay, friends, and dad forced the boy to drink that entire cup of urine, somebody else's urine. The boy was really, really hurt. Friends, he was so hurt, that day he said, "Dad, when I grow up, I'm going to give you a tit for tat." But by the time he joined the seminary, friends, that time the anchor was formed, okay? When he joined the seminary, his dad died of heart attack. Now he started feeling bad. Oh, my dad, even though he was strict with me, he led a very holy life, very religious minded man, very devout Catholic. So sure he's in heaven. I'm not supposed to be angry with my dad. So he thought he had forgiven it. Actually, the anchor was deep inside. Friends, until after his final vows, okay, when he was sent to a community, he had a superior who was very strict. Okay, one day when superior took action on him because he didn't go for prayer, he said, "You better skip the breakfast, okay? For you don't want mass and prayer, you want breakfast. Huh? You better go fasting, then you would understand how important mass is." Okay, friends, that day he was triggered. He turned against a superior at the age of 30. When he came to me, he was 50. He was avenging every superior, every authority person. Okay, friends? So the moment the superior told him, "No breakfast for you because you didn't come for mass." Friends, from that day, the anchor was released. For 20 years, he was going about punishing everybody. Friends, until he realized he had a lot of unfinished business with his dad and processed it. Afterwards, he became the provincial, okay? And very good man. Okay, friends, that is about the Avenger Lock. Friends, when somebody has got unprocessed anger toward a parent, that means you had a lot of anger toward either your mom or dad, and you could never release it. You could never process it. So such people, friends, in fact, these people, they are highly subservient during formation time. Okay? They can, friends, even they are not aware of this. Do you know? A lot of people who have an Avenger Lock, they are very submissive during formation time. Friends, you being formators, have you come across that situation? You might have seen some formies. That's why I don't trust anybody who is very subservient. "Yes, Father. Good morning, Father. Good evening, Father." And too eager to serve you. But deep inside, you know, they have a lot of pent-up anger. When does it come out? Friends, when they are playing games, sometimes they erupt with a terrible anger. Okay, friends, whenever they are unconscious, they show that anger. Now and then that anger erupts. We have to address it. Why? He might be having Avenger lock. Okay, friends. In the Bible, we have Herodias, who has got Avenger lock. Even though she knew that John the Baptist was an upright man, he was a saint, just because he made a statement against her, she even tried to mow him down and murder him brutally. Friends, Hitler is a strong example of Avenger lock. Somebody who had a strong Avenger lock but who released it and became healthy was Nelson Mandela. Friends, next one is emotion lock. What is an emotion lock? There are people who cannot release their emotions that easily. Okay, friends? They all the time bottle up their emotions. Friends, I'll give you an example of emotion lock, okay? Friends, once I had been to a sisters community, and all the sisters were referring to one sister, little elderly sister. They said, she's a saint. She never gets trouble with anybody. She's very forgiving. She's very, very good to people. We all love her very much. And they were making fun of her and having a good joke and all that. I looked at her. She said, yeah, I don't get into trouble with anybody. I'm a very peaceful person. Okay. Then I right away asked her, sister, do you have a blood pressure? She said, high blood pressure. She said, whatever sickness, you name it, I have it. Friends, do you think she's really peaceful person? She doesn't have anger at all. In fact, she has got this emotion lock. That means she never tries to show her emotions. Okay? Friends, suppressing her anger repeatedly, she has so many sicknesses. Okay, friends? This is one example. But there could be so many types of emotion locks. People who all the time bottle up their emotions. Okay? Then it shows up in their physical health. Friends, sorry to mention this. Sorry, I'm not against that saint. I love her very much. Okay? But just for the sake of giving an example, I have to give. You know, Saint Teresa of Child Jesus. Okay? She said, I would rather die than get angry with anybody. Saying this, you know, she all the time was trying to be nice and goody-goody with everybody. Friends, she's a heroine according to me, okay? Tremendous virtues. But she was suppressing her anger so much, she developed complications and died at a young age. Same way in India, we have Saint Alphonsa, a great saint, Indian saint, who also died very young because she never ever released her emotions. Okay, friends? Friends, same thing can be true of some saints, even like Saint Anthony of Padua. He died a young person because he never ever showed his emotions to people. Okay? So there are many saints. Friends, those years that was a spirituality. We accept them. But now the way we describe spirituality, the way we define spirituality has changed. So friends, some of us, when we were children, our parents all the time said, good boys don't get angry, good girls don't throw tantrums. So they all the time were not comfortable with our showing emotions. So what happened? We suppressed those emotions. Okay, friends? Such people, when we grow up, we may not be even empathetic toward others. We can develop apathy. Friends, sometimes have you heard lay people passing comment on religious people saying that they are heartless people? It could be this one. Friends, Steve Jobs, you know, the proprietor of Apple company, iPhone, he was a very intelligent guy, very capable, but he had a lot of emotion locks. Sorry, I have no much time to describe this. He had a lot of emotion locks and he did not deal with that properly. He died at a young age. Okay, friends, before death, he said, I wish I had learned the art of handling emotions and now I would be alive. I would be alive for many years. He made that statement. Whereas, same way Stalin. Friends, somebody who is a great successful CEO at the same time, she handles her emotions so well. Okay, that is Indira Nooyi, the CEO of PepsiCo company. Okay, very good example. Friends, sometimes those, friends, next lock is called the deceit lock. What is a deceit lock? Have you come across religious people who are, you know, they have like a double standard? In front of you, they behave one way. At your back, they are different. Like Judas in the Bible. Okay, he kissed Jesus in front of him, but betrayed Jesus at the back. Friends, have you come across people? Sure, everybody. Okay. Who are very goody-goody to you in front and say, you know, Father, you gave a sermon, excellent sermon, very inspiring sermon and all that. And then after he leaves, he said, this fellow, big show off. I can preach a sermon much better than this. Who do you think he is? He thinks he's a big saint. Whatever he was preaching, lousy, lousy sermon. Have you heard people? They say something in front of you and they say the opposite at your back. Then that is called deceit lock. Friends, a lot of children who feel lonely and they are unable to trust even their parents. So children, you know, naturally they trust their parents and they get abused by their parents in the childhood. Friends, later on, you know, and they become deceitful. See, when children are very open and frank, parents punish them. When children are crafty and deceitful, parents appreciate them. Okay? Like, friends, have you seen in this drama called King Lear by Shakespeare, where dad all the time supports the girls who are very deceitful and he rejects the daughter who is very open and frank. Okay? Friends, if parents are behaving like that, children can become very deceitful. Okay, later on, they have double dealing all the time. Friends, the president of North Korea is a very deceitful man. Did you see recently? Sorry, I'm not speaking politics. I'm speaking about personalities. Friends, do you know recently twice he made a big drama that he was dead? You know why he himself created this drama? To observe the behaviors of his ministers and people very close to him, right? He wanted to see who was trying to take power and all that, okay? Friends, somebody, when he sort of gave an impression that he was dead, immediately they started discussing and who wants to be the next president and all that. So what he did, he came back and eliminated those people, pushed them out, okay? So he doesn't want anybody to challenge him. So very deceitful man. Friends, Abraham Lincoln, okay, he came from a deceitful situation, but he became a very upright person. Next one is called arrogance lock. You know, what is arrogance lock? I'm okay, you are not okay. Okay, friends, this is arrogance lock. Friends, in the childhood, sorry to save time, I'm not giving you illustrations now. Okay. Friends, some religious people, when they were small, You know, their parents were really dominating and they were very arrogant. And the child can meet the needs only by being very adamant and being very arrogant. So those children later develop arrogance. So when these people become religious, have you seen them looking down on people belonging to other ethnicity? Either people belonging to other countries or ethnic groups or language, they put on others. And all the time, you know, show that they are great. Friends, they all the time show to the community members, I am better than you. So these people, usually they do bragging. Okay, I'm the son of Mysore Maharaja. I'm the son of grandson of Cochin Maharaja. I'm the great-great son of King George of England. Okay, so they keep on bragging and boasting. And they also put down others in the public. They develop narcissistic personality. Okay, friends, that is arrogance lock. Okay, I know everything attitude. Friends, in the Bible, we have Jezebel in the Old Testament, who was an arrogant woman. Napoleon Bonaparte, he was a good example of arrogance. He was so arrogant, he even dominated and persecuted Catholic Church. Okay, he suppressed all congregations. He's a very arrogant man. Okay, friends, a good example, positive, is Barack Obama. Okay, friends, he also came from a little suppressive family situation, but he was able to grow out of it. Friends, after retiring, he came down from his presidentship. You know, he started working in a little soup kitchen restaurant serving people. Imagine, president now working as a little, you know, a bearer in a little restaurant, willing to serve poor people. Okay, good. Friends, next thing is ethnicity lock that is there in our religious blood. Friends, children who were exposed to strong ethnicity in their home. You know, like there are different ethnic groups. In India, we say caste feeling or ethnic groups. And they are exposed to ethnic combats and fights and all that. Friends, such people can later, they can develop strong affinity toward their group, ethnic group. Once they become religious, have you seen that? They want to become provincials and generals, and then they try to do favors to people of their group, and they try to harm the other group. Friends, that is ethnicity lock. Friends, right now, this is so prevalent in almost all the religious congregations. No congregation is exempt. We are all victims of this, but gradually these things will change. So friends, you can check the formies whether they were exposed to ethnicity before the age of 6. All those who were exposed to strong ethnic combats and ethnic distinction before the age of 6, friends, it might have been anchored in their mind. They might, you know, work on it once they try to get power. These people also, you know, do everything in order to come to power, and they are very favorable to their group. Friends, Trump is a good example of this. He's a racist. Okay. All the time supporting one ethnic group and he's against another group. Whereas Nelson Mandela, what he did, friends, when he became the president, he made a white man, D. Clark, as his vice president. Okay, a man who is very open. Next one is called a stubbornness lock. Being very stubborn. Okay. Friends, the best example is Pharisees in the Bible. Okay. Friends, whenever children, they have some emotions, parents totally ignore their emotions. They don't pay attention to the emotions of the child. Okay. Friends, for example, little boy comes home and starts crying to mom. Mom, my teacher really beat me. I'm upset. No, mom says, you must have done something wrong. That's why your teacher beat you. Okay, try to behave. So she totally ignores his emotions. Friends, such children, in order to put forward his emotion, he has to be very stubborn. Okay, he has to really, really put his foot down heavily. Only then parents notice his emotion. So such people later on, they become very stubborn. Okay, have you come across people who are very conservatives in our congregation, who don't want anything new? They don't want any renewal. Status quo is the best, and they are conservative. They even try to go back to their history, I mean, in a negative way. Okay, friends, we see Pharisees in the Bible. Okay, they have terrible stubbornness lock. Friends, I'll go forward, sorry. Yeah, the next one is called a self-depreciation lock. What is this? Friends, whenever somebody is developing a shame around any aspect of themselves in the childhood, they are ashamed of something. Later on, they have self-depreciation. They develop inferiority complex. Okay, friends? But after they are full-fledged, they try to react. Okay? Friends, a good example for this is, one Michael Jackson. Okay, friends, Michael Jackson, when he was a little boy, his dad made fun of his nose. Okay, and he called him umbrella nose. Friends, this is how he looked as a young boy. No, he really looks good, handsome. But dad called him umbrella nose. So friends, he developed a terrible complex around his appearance. He was ashamed of himself. You know what he did in his life? He had gone through 34 surgeries on his body, trying to get better and better. Okay, finally, he ended up becoming like this. Okay, friends, which is better, the previous photo or this one? He looks so handsome. But this man kept on doing, you know, treatment and surgery, trying to change his color, change everything. And finally, you know, he got depressed and, he became a drug addict and he died. Okay, that is this one. Friends, there's a good example which you can even share with your formies called Lupita Nyong'o. Friends, Lupita Nyong'o, she was born in Kenya. Okay, at the age of five, her dad was transferred to Mexico. He was a college professor. He was transferred to Mexico. There he was a professor in the university. This girl at the age of five, she went to Mexico. And the first day, you know, she was 5 years old, she went to school. When she entered the classroom, she had a shock. Everybody in the classroom was white. You know, they had fair complexion. She was the only girl who was dark, black in color. Friends, right away, all the children laughed at her. You know, Mexicans are, they have Spanish background. They are fair in complexion, most of them, especially the area she was in. You know, they were all fair looking. And everybody laughed at this girl because she was dark in complexion. Now the teacher laughed so much. And looking at little Lupita, she said, Lupita, you are the ugliest girl in the classroom. You know what? There's one thing I'm sure. No boy would ever like to get married later. Imagine 5-year-old girl, being really put down, and she was humiliated. Friends, she developed a terrible, this complex. I am not beautiful at all. I'm ugly looking. She, being a Catholic, she was fond of Mother Mary. She would all the time hold the picture of Mother Mary and say, Mother Mary, I don't like you. See, you are looking so beautiful and so fair. And why did Jesus create me this way? I'm angry with you, Mother Mary. I'm angry with Jesus. And then she said, Mother Mary, let us make a deal. Okay? Every night, she bought us some lotion, like Fair and Lovely lotion, you know, cream, facial cream. And she said, Mother Mary, I will apply a lot of this lotion on my face. I'll go to bed. When I wake up, I want to look little fairer. Okay, so in few months, I have to become white like other people. Mother Mary, please help. Friends, every time she applied and she went to bed, okay, she woke up, she was the same color. Okay, after 2-3 months, there was no difference. So she got disgusted. She was angry with Mother Mary. She grew up with this terrible shame that she was not good looking. Okay, friends, later, for her college studies, she was sent to California. She did studies, her bachelor's in communication. And that time she was feeling so down. Okay. Once she saw a movie called The Purple. Okay. Friends, in that the heroine of the movie was one Whoopi Goldberg. You might know this actor. Okay. If you had seen this movie called Sister Act, most of you would have seen that, right? Sister Act. She acts in that. A good comedian, excellent actor. Okay. Lupita looked at Whoopi Goldberg and said, hey, Whoopi Goldberg looks exactly like me, dark in complexion, okay? But she's an excellent actor. If she can be the heroine of a movie, why not I? Friends, from that time, she started feeling little better. One day, her mom said, honey, if you feel you're beautiful, the world will see you as a beautiful girl. If you think you are ugly, the world also will do the same. World is a mirror. Friends, from that day, she started looking into the mirror and she started saying, Lupita, you are a beautiful girl. Okay, friends, very soon, she was taken to Hollywood for practical sessions. One afternoon, she was in a cafeteria having lunch with her, friends. There was somebody who was looking at her from a corner. And then afterwards, he walked up to her and said, hello, what's your name? She said, Lupita. Lupita, I'm the director of a movie. Okay. I'm looking for an actor who would fit into a particular role. Looking at you, I have a hunch that you will very well fit into that role. Would you like to come for acting? She said, absolutely. Friends, she acted in that movie and many other movies, 12 Years of Slave. Okay, that movie and many other movies. Then she got Oscar Award. So in the year 2017, a magazine called the People Magazine conducted, not every year they conduct this beauty contest. Okay, the most beautiful celebrity. So they publish about 25 celebrities, women and men. And people have to go online and tick 1, 2, 3. You know, the most beautiful or handsome person, 1, 2, 3. Okay, friends, in the year 2017, Lupita was chosen the most beautiful person in the whole world. Okay, and she was awarded. Friends, this is how she started looking later. Okay, she became number one in beauty contest. Okay, friends, then she said, her teacher told her, no boy would ever, you know, like to get married to you. She said, so far I have received more than 100 love letters from celebrities who want to get married to me. Friends, recently she got married. She leads a happy life. Then she says, no, earlier when I saw myself as an ugly person, I was ugly to the whole world. They put me down. But the day I started looking at myself and I said, I am beautiful, the world also saw me as a beautiful person. Okay, friends, this is self-depreciation lock. Friends, so when we have formies who are going through this, it has to be addressed early on. Otherwise, later on, they might even go out of the way to prove to others in a negative way, you know, like they might become jealous of others, they might destroy others if they feel inferior to them. Anybody who is self-depreciating, they either destroy themselves or others. Okay, friends? Friends, There are a few more locks. Now we have hardly 15 minutes. Okay. And you have to interact as well. Okay, friends. Friends, I have everything, all the details in the PowerPoint. We will send that to you. Going through that, you have all the details. Okay. I have also explained how our formies can be guided. They can come out of this locks, mind locks. Friends, foremost, it'll be nice if you can apply all this to yourself. You know, being formators, I have to be aware of my locks and I have to follow a certain techniques in order to come out of it. Okay. Friends, afterwards, you can apply this to the formies. Okay. Now the forum is open for interaction. You are welcome to intervene.